Victor, can you believe it? It's 2021, I think, right?
That's absolutely right. Yes, amazing. And we all made it. We're still here.
Man,
right? Back in 2000, Y2K, we were wondering if we were going to get through that.
We did, and it's been almost a year since we commenced these, or at least it's been 10 or 11 months. And I couldn't think of a better way to begin the year than with our esteemed colleagues here. And it's like I always say, one of the best things about these for me is that there's no need to introduce anybody, because we just go and get all our greatest inspirations and our greatest friends, and we just bring us all together, and we find a topic to talk about, and the next thing you know, it's tomorrow and we're still talking.
Steve, I think we should just start by thanking these people, you know, because I mean, it does happen every time, you know, we get the greatest of the greats. It keeps getting better. And these people are, you know, giving us their time and their knowledge, and they've been doing that their whole lives, our whole lives for sure. So a big thank you to all of you for being here and sharing with us, you know, and giving so much of your lives to all of us. We appreciate you all so much.
Thank you. I mean, they told us back in March that we couldn't meet with students anymore. We couldn't play concerts. We couldn't travel. We couldn't go anywhere. And that just didn't sit well with some of us. So we're just grateful that we all see the value in keeping our community alive, inspiring other people, letting other people know that what they're going through is not that much different than what any of us are going through. We're all suffering in various ways. But at the same time, I think that there's that silver lining to everything. And what I'm looking at on my screen right now, I wouldn't have imagined a year ago. And I don't think, maybe Victor Wooten would have thought of it. I'm not sure about that either, but it takes sometimes a tragedy to create destiny in the way that we've done it. So I'm just grateful for everybody being here. As the audience probably noticed, we got a room full of bass players and a drummer who's got a bass player right over there over his right shoulder. So welcome to the club, Vince. Most of us have been here before. Daryl, John, Marcus, Mr. Carter. We've got a couple new faces. And what we like to do at the beginning, especially for the new folks, is give us a short synopsis of where you were when COVID started, what was going on, and what's developed in the ensuing months. I know that many of us have been active in various ways, and some of us has been active in unexpected ways, like Victor being able to visit his son's school a lot and all those kind of great things. But welcome, Dave Holland. It's been on my bucket list.
What's to up, get Dave?
You.
Thanks.
So tell us where you were, what happened.
It was beginning of March, and I was just starting a tour in Europe with Kenny Barron and Jonathan Blake, great piano player and drummer. And we were in the UK playing Ronnie Scott's, and things were just starting to develop. And we were hearing some rumbling about gigs possibly being canceled on the tour. And we had these three nights at Ronnie's, and I was doing the elbow bump then, you know, and people were already like, what are you doing? You know, give me a hug and that kind of stuff. I said, no, I'm trying to protect you, you know. So we finished the three nights, and then we were deciding whether to go on to the next gig, which was in Portugal, in Oporto. The gig was supposed to carry on. We got to the airport, we went to Oporto, and when we landed, the guy that met us at the airport said the gig's canceled. The government's closed down all the concerts. So it was clear that things were just going to be falling apart. So we all decided just to come back to New York. at that point, President Trump had decided to block people coming into the States. I mean, we all had American passports, but clearly things were shutting down. So we said, let's just go home, be with our families, and be safe. And that was the last live performance I've done since then. So.
But just looking at your background there, Dave, I've already got questions just seeing what's behind you, and I'm going to save those for later too. But I noticed on another stream that headless electric bass sitting in the corner, and somebody out here is just talking about Dave Holland and the electric bass, but I'm going to come back to that. I'm just putting it out there in case I forget. Vince Wilburn, so great to see you, and welcome for your inaugural. There's been three inaugurations, one a couple days ago, and today we've got the inaugural visit of Dave Holland and Vince Wilburn on the whatever we call these things, Vic.
Thanks for having me, Steve. And hey, I'm blessed to be amongst my heroes.
Another VW. I love it.
Yeah. The day we got wind of the pandemic was, I think I was at a screening for Ray Parker Jr.'s documentary, and here in LA and Hollywood, and you know, we were all actually kind of social distancing then, because there wasn't that many people in the theater. I mean, it was spread out, and I think Daryl, you were there, and we talked to people were trying to take photos with us all, you know. We were like, well, no. Because we knew it was something, but we didn't know how serious it was. And we had just finished, director Stanley Nelson and I had just finished screening the documentary all around the world. And we planned on going to Japan. And when it came down, we had to stop everything, you know. I was working on a project with Daryl and Mr. Carter with Lenny White and I co-producing, and we had to shut that down. But luckily we recorded the record, but we couldn't mix it and tour to support it because of what happened. So, you know, you try to, you know, keep a positive mind and create as much as I can or we can in the space that we have in the studios and communicate with each other. That's important, you know. Daryl was dropping by socially distancing on the weekends, and you know, it's good to see people that you love, and it helps kind of navigate through tough times. So, you know, can't wait to get back out and play and see everybody. You know, it's important. That's our lifeline.
Yeah. Yes, true. I know that a lot of people out there watching and listening would agree with me that all of you in the window, plus a few more, have really helped us get through this pandemic through your music. Because even me right now, I have a whole lot of time to listen in ways that I haven't in the past. Like I, you know, a lot of us are on tour. And for me, when I'm on tour so much, I get off the stage, I'm kind of ready for quiet, and I don't do a lot of listening, you know, on the tour bus or whatever. But I've been doing a whole lot more listening now that I'm home and I have the time. My kids go to private school or whatever, and they're gone, and I'm sitting around the house, and I can listen, you know. And you guys, I'm serious to say it, you guys and some of the ladies out there too, have really helped us get through it all with the music, the years of stuff that you've given to us. So we appreciate you for that. Have any of you been, you know, listening to anything new? I've been able to speak with Mr. Carter quite a bit and get to watch him listen to some of his own stuff that he hadn't heard in many years. But anybody listening to anything interesting in this time?
Yeah, what's on your playlist, Marcus?
Let's see. Some 1960s Wynton Kelly with Hank Mobley. The low F on Ron Carter's bass on Seven Steps to Heaven. Y'all know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
right at the end of the chorus. Beep bong.
Yes.
See, that's why he makes y'all play that same note over and over again for 3 hours.
Work your way up to the scale. And
No, not even the scale yet. Just play that note.
Yeah.
What else? I've been listening to stuff that was part of my teen years. There's nothing more cool than listening to something as an adult that you used to listen to as a kid and seeing, you know, the stuff that I didn't understand as a kid that I understand now, this stuff that I realized, no, I got it even as a teenager, you know what I mean? So that kind of stuff is cool.
So I'd love to go to you, Mr. Carter. And since we're making that pivot into Miles, and I've gone online and I've seen so much where you all have individually talked about your relationship with Miles and the gigs and everything. And one of the big questions that it seems to be asked a lot is how did you get the gig with Miles? And that's well covered. People can Google that, but I'm more curious of your perspective of why you got the gig with Miles. Like, what was it about you? Because I mean, obviously Miles is an excellent judge of musicianship and potential, but I'm just curious from your perspective, and we'll start with Mr. Carter, why did you get that gig? What skill sets brought you there? And just in general, why not how?
You know, I've been asked that kind of question, and I've always felt uncomfortable because I couldn't really answer it because I don't know what Miles was hearing. And I always kind of felt that it was his responsibility to answer that question because he was listening to more bass players to replace Paul Chambers than I was doing the list to replace Paul Chambers. I had met Miles before in Rochester, New York, at a concert that is called Jazz for Moderns. Back in the day when they have 8 or 9 jazz bands on the same program, they had Amanda Ferguson's big band. We had Wayne Shorter in it and the Slat Hampton and Dave Brubeck had Gene Wright in it and Joe Morello and Paul. Lamont Hendricks and Ross were in it. It's a really good show and Miles's band. And this is one of the continuing stops on the tours that went from Canada through upstate New York by train to New York City. And however they made the arrangement, someone was supposed to take Miles' band to the train station from the Eastman Theater. Well, when the concert was over, whoever it was didn't show up or they couldn't find him. So whoever the producer, George Wien or someone said, can you give Miles a ride to the train station? I said, okay. So I had a 1950 Ford and Miles and me and someone, one of his friends got into my car. We drove to the train station and I kind of let it go. A nice experience. I'm in school. I got a year and a half to go before I graduate from Eastman School of Music and I had put the time in. I wasn't going to quit because I had too much invested and I thought I could still learn something there. And I kind of let it go. I had seen him occasionally, but we never spoke. And he's always doing what he was doing. I'm not kind of the person who likes to hang around and I say hello and how are you? I'm being courteous. So I have my hat nearby and just put it on and I might see you, you know. I just found out the other day, not having read Miles's biography, that this person who read it told me that Miles, they asked him this kind of question, why am I in the band? He said that he had met me in Rochester, New York, and he knew when Paul was going to leave, he tried to find someone else. And somehow he remembered me from Rochester, New York. And he thought that for whatever reason he had done his own research, he thought that I'd be the guy who could replace Paul Chambers in the band. So he came down to the Half Note where I was working with Jim Hall, Art Farmer, and Walter Perkins, and mentioned that Paul left the band. They were going to form a trio with the West Montgomery Quartet, Wynton Kelly, Paul, and Jimmy Cobb. But Jimmy's going to finish the tour with him because he had 6 weeks out in California and basically had no band. Ultimately, he hired Harold Maven on the piano, Frank Strozier on alto and George Coleman on tenor, and this was the tour. Anyway, he said he was leaving the day after tomorrow. I said, well, Mr. Davis, because I never called him Miles until we got in the band for a while. Mr. Davis, I got a job already. I'm working with Art Farmer. I've committed my time to him. You know, so, but if you ask him if he'll let me go, if he says yes, absolutely. If he says no, I'm comfortable right here with Art Farmer and Jim Hall. I told him I was going to be here. So he went over to Art Farmer and told him Art Farmer that he had put together a band and that he wanted me to join the day after tomorrow. And I told him that I wouldn't go until Art gave him permission. And Art said, okay, you got my permission. From that relationship came two things. Art Farmer was stunned that I would turn down the gig to play with Miles to play with him. And he admired my nerve, my chutzpah. Davis, no, I got a job. With Art Farmer, he just heard a set, man, you know? And with Miles, he understood that when I have a commitment, I have a commitment. And there aren't many things that are going to come along, least of all going to a better band, than to quit this band in the middle of the third course of I Got Rhythm and going somewhere else. he understood that. And I think that was the basis of him, our musical relationship. We never talked about music. We talked about the stock market. We talked about the black politicians in Harlem. Miles is kind of a boxer, so I knew the names of the guys he's talking about. Tony Anthony, I knew those guys, you know, from TV. We talked about clothes. We went to the driving range, but we never talked about music. And through all my times with the 5 years or so I spent with him, all the gigs we made, he asked me only one time. We're doing Autumn Leaves again. That was the first tune of all the shows. It didn't matter where we were, what the language was, that was the downbeat. And after a while, I just kind of had enough of playing the last chord of the tune, a G minor. I said, man, we can't do this. We're not going to do this shit. No, man. So we get to the Miles' call. He's, you know, got his hip suit on and is really dressed elegantly as well, and he's doing what he does. And rather than play a G minor chord, I play the G, B, D, F, with the B on the first note. And he jumped, but he kept playing, you know. I said, he walked back after doing wind solo, and I'm 6'4", and he's about 5'11", and he's trying to reach up to me and talk at the playing time. He said, what was that note? I said, that was a B natural, a G7, and don't talk to me now because I can't play and talk at the same time. And those are the last words she spoke to me on the bandstand. Those are the only words about music we ever talked about. He trusted my judgment. He allowed me to play what I heard, hoping that I could figure out that either it was working great or it was not working so great. He thought I would figure that stuff out because I just turned down him to join Art Farmer. If I felt that, then I'm supposed to be there. And the only way I will not be there is if I quit. I was not unfireable. I think nobody is. But I think when you're talking to Jesus, you tell Jesus, no, I'm going to go with Paul, you know. Yeah. You tell Jesus, no, if you tell Jesus, I'm not wearing sandals and the short pants. No, we're not going to do
that. That's not my look.
Yeah. That's not my era, you know. I'm a long blonde hair. Yeah, I'm okay, you know. Through all this time, he trusted my judgment. And he would always ask me when he put the mute down and walked back on stage, he always asked me, was he out of tune? I said, yes. Sharp. Because I couldn't talk more than that. Flat. You know? Because when the horn gets cold and the stage gets hot, the real dynamics of the air, you know? And I tried to explain to him, the sharper you get, man, the more it hurts my hands trying to catch up to the pitch. And I'd rather not do that all night if I can tell you that you're sharp or flat. So feel free to ask me, but you don't get one word, sharp or flat.
Not gonna say. Low notes with the mute, they get sharp, real sharp, don't they, on the trumpet?
Yeah, man, it puts on the piano and the lights sharpen on it, you know, and Herbie's notes are going over the trumpet. He's playing all his stuff on the piano and the notes, he said, Miles, please. I paid the band. I checked the reservations for the hotels and stuff. I paid.
Somebody just asked that. Somebody wanted to know if you were the manager for a while, the road manager.
Well, Not really. I handled the money on the road, and I made the reservations at the hotel, but somebody else did that real heavy legwork.
Right.
I guess Miles trusted me and the band to dispense the money, and the guys in the band trusted me to give them whatever Miles gave them. So it was kind of a nice relationship that was developing because of his trust in me. And he thought that this is the guy who can do what we try to do.
You still playing that G7 over that last chord?
Yes, sir. I had F sharp sometimes too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's how you get back to the top.
That's correct.
Yeah, that pushes you back to the top. Yeah. I don't know about that F sharp. That's something else.
I'm telling you, Marcus. I'm telling you. Make the note before, the beat four I mentioned before is F natural.
Yes.
The last two beats of the turnaround is F sharp.
Yeah.
Down at the top of the course is a G, which is the fifth of the C minor chord.
Yeah.
Perfect. Then you go C, then C sharp for the next two beats, then D for the next two beats, then E flat for the next two beats.
Chromatically, yeah.
F, which is a C, the third in the bass. F is the third of the D minor chord. F sharp in the bass, which is the D7, the third in the bass. And G, which is the last two. Yeah, it's perfect, man.
Mm. Oh.
I love to see this many bass players. As you're stating those notes, I can see everybody's head picturing them on the instrument. Where is that, and how is that leading back? But Mr. Carter, it definitely sounds like Marcus Miller needs to visit your F blues clinic, starting on a D flat.
Yeah, man, Marcus, that's it, man.
I see Professor Lenny White is in the house. Lenny, it's great to see you. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. I made it. I got back in time. I made it.
And everything worked out. It's all good.
Everything worked out. Yes, sir.
Yes. Yes, but
what's up, big brother?
Nene!
What's up? Jamaica Queens in the house. Hey.
What's up, Machine Gun?
What's up, baby? Just chilling. You know. Wow. Mr. Carter.
Hey, GB here.
GB there. GB there. Mr. Dave Holland, how are you?
I'm good, Lenny. Good to see you.
And is that Munch there somewhere? Yes, I see him.
How are you, Lenny?
Hey, what's going on? David, how are you?
I'm well, sir. Thank you.
And wait. Where's Mr. Come on.
Mr. Wooten?
I can't see. Yeah, there it is. Mr. Wooten. There he is. Yes, sir. I don't know you guys. I've witnessed all the things that you've played on. Yes, but it's really great to see you guys. It's fantastic. Is this a bass thing?
It is. It's where you get to talk about it. But
Mr. Patitucci, is this a bass thing? Is this a bass thing? Yeah, okay. Cool.
Hey, Lenny has three bass licks that he can play. They're very fun.
That's so too much. Well, Dave Holland, you and I know you have a history with Lenny as well, as does everybody in here, but can you pick us up from that late 60s era where the transition with the Miles group was starting to happen? And I, like I said, I've heard so much about how it happened, but I'm curious if you have, like Mr. Carter, any introspective on why it was you.
Well, I'll echo what Mr. Carter said, you know, about not being able to really address what Miles was thinking. I had never met him or played with him before, and I'd been living in London about 4 years, and one of my gigs was to work at the Ronnie Scott Club. And I was working in a support band with a piano trio and a singer, a very good singer, Elaine Del Mar. And Bill Evans was the main featured act with Jack DeJohnette and Eddie Gomez. And it was about a 3-week gig, I would say. And one night during the night, somebody said to me, Miles has come in the club, you know. And I was kind of shy when I was younger. And also I always feel that, you know, you don't want to be bugging somebody, especially somebody of that stature. He gets talked to all the time by people that just want to bend his ear, you know. So I just got on with doing the gig and didn't. The good thing was I kind of thought to myself, he's not going to be listening to what we're doing. You know, he's going to be, you know, talking to Bill, because he had a table at the back of the club. Philly Joe Jones had been living in London for about a year. And Philly was in there hanging out. And that was my first misunderstanding about Miles, I guess, figuring that he wouldn't be listening, you know, because I think he was always checking things out and being aware of what was going on. But, you know, I was just trying to play for the music and play for the gig. I was playing acoustic bass and some nice arrangements that the pianist had done. And I really don't know what he heard. I know that later I got to understand that Ron had left the band more or less. I think I'm correct about this. I had seen the band in London in 67 when they came there in November. It was a double bill with Archie Shepp's band. And, you know, I remember being struck that the music I heard, it was nothing like what I'd heard on record. You know, it was already moved on from whatever the last record I'd been listening to. You know, the last thing I expected was that he was looking for a bass player. I thought Ron was still in the band. And towards the end of the night, Philly Joe came up to me and said, Miles wants you to join his band. And, you know, you can imagine, I was just stunned. I was like, I thought he was kidding me. I thought he was joking, you know. So something he heard, you know, I've always tried to just play for the music and play the best I could, you know. But that was the only time he'd heard me. And I waited about 3 weeks and got a call from Jack Whittemore, who was the manager and agent for Miles. About 2 a.m, I got a call. It was a Tuesday, I remember. And he said, can you be in New York on Friday to start a 3-week gig at the Count Basie Club in New York? And that was it. I didn't have to think twice about that. I'd been wanting to come to New York. This was in the summer of 68. So I'd been planning on taking a trip to New York. I'd met a lot of friends, made a lot of friends who were from New York that had come through London. And they kind of encouraged me to come. And, you know, the last thing I expected was to arrive in New York with a gig with Miles Davis. I mean, that just was an incredible moment to have that opportunity. I didn't know if I would last for one night, two nights, three nights. I didn't know how long it would go on, but I figured, you know, the experience, even if it was just one night, was going to be incredible and something I would learn a lot from, hopefully. Well, the first night, I remember Ron came into the club, I think, and was there. And I remember feeling, you know, what an amazing contribution Ron had made to that music. And, of course, the band had been together for 4 or 5 years. And my first thing was, you know, trying to figure out how to fit into the music. There was a lot of things that were happening that were understood and not talked about. I mean, there was no written music. We had no rehearsal beforehand. I didn't know what the set list was going to be or anything. And the only chance I had was the night before. On the Thursday night, I went to Herbie's house, and very graciously, he spent some time with me showing some of the songs that I hadn't figured out. You know, as Ron was talking about playing different bass notes, you know, some of the songs, he did not play the root of the chord. So,
can we talk about that, Dave?
That was like,
we will, but are you serious? Ron did not play the root of every chord? Come on.
You know, it was like, I was listening closely to learn from those records. I mean, this was before I had the opportunity to be in the band, and you know, he set such an example for kind of reworking the role of the instrument and the music and what it could contribute in restructuring the harmony, you know, because the bass is at the bottom of the band. It's the often playing the lowest notes in the band. And what you play there affects the sound of everything above it. And he really understands that and understood it. And so figuring out some of the songs, like some of Wayne Shorter's tunes, I was scratching my head. I was like, what the heck, you know?
Hey, so, Dave, can you remember specifically with any of those songs? I'd love to put this in a harmonic context here.
Where should I start? I mean, you know, Pinocchio, Nefertiti, Dolores, you know, I mean, so many different songs, the ballads, you know, all those records that were made. I mean, I listened to them. I come back from the gig and put the records on, you know. And of course, the sound that that Ron makes on the instrument was a great inspiration. You know, talking about that low F, I mean, I was trying to figure out how to get that sustain on the instrument, you know, that I heard him playing on there. Just the notes seemed to last forever, you know.
The timeline. Lenny, what was your first interaction with Miles, and how did that come about? Bitches Brew around 1969, I believe it was recorded and released in 70. Can you talk about that era and how it may relate to Mr. Holland and Mr. Carter?
Well, I don't know if you remember, Dave, but when you came to New York, I played with you at Mike Garson's apartment.
Wow.
In Brooklyn.
I remember.
Right.
We had a few times playing together, yeah.
Yeah, but now in terms of Jack and Tony playing, Miles wanted that to happen. And I think that's the reason why I got to play on Bitches Brew.
Yeah.
Because there was a riff. And in terms of me getting to do that, I had played a gig with two drummers, Rashid Ali and myself, at a gig in Queens at a club called the Aphrodisiac. And Benny Maupin was on that gig also. And it was a trumpet player that was, you know, a friend of Miles or whatever, and he tried to beat Miles, and his name was Dion. And remember Dion, right? So we played this gig, and during the break, he said, "Man, has Miles ever heard you play?" I said, "No." He said, "Man, I'm gonna tell him about you." And you knew Dion, so like I was like, "Yeah, right, whatever, cuz, yeah." And sure enough, he did, and I got a call. And Vince can tell you about this true story. So, you know, Miles called my house. I was going to college at the time. I mean, so I had come home and I was there, and Miles called my house, and my mother answered the phone. And I just heard my mother say, "Who is this?" "Well, whoever you are, I don't care. You better speak up, because if you don't speak up, I'm going to hang this phone up." And so he spoke up, and then she handed the phone to me, and it was Miles. And Miles said, "Listen, I'd like for you to be at my house for a rehearsal." And that was it. And I came to Miles's house for rehearsal. It was Jack, it was Chick, Dave, and Wayne. And all we rehearsed, do you remember, Dave? All we rehearsed was do 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 do. But and all I had was a cymbal and a snare drum. That's all I had. And we rehearsed that, and he said, "Be at Columbia Studios at 10 o'clock tomorrow." I was on the moon, man. I mean, like, you know, these are guys that I had listened to all my life, and then I get an opportunity to come and do this. and play with them. I mean, and like, it was amazing. And the thing about it, which is so deep, is of course there's no music and there's 13 people in the studio, and Miles comes to me and he says, think of this as a big pot of stew and I want you to be salt. What musical knowledge am I going to call upon to sound like salt? So I had no idea what to do. And I was just around all these people and Jack, everybody was really cool, man. And, you know, cause I was a young guy there. I was like a deer in headlights, and just to have that opportunity was really a great opportunity. It's my first recording that I had done. So.
So Vince,
hold on. Hey Lenny, what's this?
Oh, that's the bass drum that I've, hey Ron, there it is.
Wait, that's the bass drum from that rehearsal you're talking about?
No, that's the bass drum from Bitches Brew. And then I went and played that on Red Clay, and Ron Carter said, no. He said, no, you can't play that bass drum, that doesn't work, no. So that's some legendary stuff right there. And that's the proof. There it is right there.
Bass drum.
Did you really change the bass drum?
I had to. Rudy Van Gelder went in the back and pulled out this like 28-inch bass drum that had a painting of a moonlit lake on the front of the bass. And it sounded like you were hitting somebody in the face when you hit the... I hated the sound of that bass drum. It was so traumatic for me. I'm getting ready to play with Herbie Hancock and Ron Carter and Freddie Hubbard and Joe Henderson, and I can't play the drums that I want to play. I got to play some, you know.
Yeah, so I took Lenny outside. To Lenny, is this record really important to you? So, man, you're kidding me, important? Yeah. I said, do you want to play on this record? Oh, yeah.
Then leave that damn bass drum away.
I said, Lenny, you really don't know me too well, but can I speak bluntly to you? Oh, yeah, man. What do you got to say? This is for the general audience. Lenny, if you're going to make this fucking music, leave that fucking drum outside and play Rudy. Otherwise, the shit is home and we're all going home with no music at all. You want that? No, man. No man will leave that shit outside. Let's go to work, brother.
It wasn't really traumatic, but you know.
The truth.
It took a couple of therapists to work through that, right?
And Freddie had no real music. He just had kind of sketches and stuff.
Yeah, right.
And the first tune we play when we go back after me and Lenny having an agreement. What do 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 do?
Red Clay, right? So I had to play a beat.
Yeah, and he had no bass part, just the kind of sunny changes.
Exactly. Yeah. So I played this beat, and Ron had that bass line. It worked out, man.
Let's do this, Lenny. Yeah, and we had a great. We still have a great time, but that's the story of how that happened, man.
Yeah. That was from our mouths to your ears.
Hey, Uncle Ron, did you really use those words when you pulled any outside?
Yes. Yes.
Wow. I was
about deer in headlights.
Yeah, that's exactly how I was, man.
And playing that bass drum on Intrepid Fox, I'm thinking about the 28-inch.
Thank you. You know, it's like, I was lost already, but with that bass drum, it was whoo. Steve, you know, I had put something on my snare drum too. It was a welcome mat. No, seriously, when you walk into Rudy's studio, he had a rubber welcome mat there. Mm-hmm. And I took the welcome mat and I put it on my snare drum. I said, if I'm going to have a bass drum that sounds like this, I got to have a snare drum that kind of matches that. So that's why I put it on there and played it that way.
And how many times has that been sampled? That little groove, you know, right?
Yeah.
You know, what cracks me up is we bass players are often going into the studio. We don't know the arranger very well. We not even know him or her. We don't know the library. We've got no advanced music. And the guy says, give me an 8-bar intro to this tune.
Right. That's what Freddie said to me. Hey, man, I got this tune, man. I need a B.
Yeah. Two E's.
But then, see, then he says, I played with Freddie after that a while back. He said, man, you know, yeah, man, you made me a lot of money, man. You know, with that beat, you had that beat. I said, yeah, you didn't give me none of it, you know. No.
You know what? And it cracks me up because at Berkeley, you know, we have so many hundreds of bass students every year. And when Ron Carter was our visiting artist last semester, everybody, you know, the greatest double bass player in you know, of that era and one of my biggest influences and on the totem pole. And then I would say, do you know the bass line to Red Clay? And go, yeah, every bass player knows, but that's electric bass. I don't want to talk. No, I said, wait a minute. Do you know who played that bass line? It's amazing how many students, you know, put us in a box and don't realize that every jazz bass player knows a Ron Carter electric bass line. When you really think about it, it puts it in perspective.
Wow.
So Vince, I know you're related to Miles. Can you talk about that for a second and anything else you want to share leading into the Miles's, I guess you would call it a vacation, and then we can pick up with Marcus.
Yeah, my mom was Miles' sister, and older by a year, and their relationship was one of, they would curse each other out, and 5 minutes later he'd call and say, Dorothy, what's for dinner? My mother's name was Dorothy. So, but they had a relationship where no one could get between that relationship. You know what I mean? Brother, sister.
Yeah.
My dad wouldn't even mess with it, you know. 75, he stopped playing because he said that he didn't have anything to say around 75, 70, around that time. And up until 79, I heard there were Miles sightings in New York. He would dip his head in a club, check out people, check out what's going on. Or guys would stop by the house on 77th and the brownstone and talk to him about, you know, who's playing what, you know, and they would, you know, tell him. And then Al was out and Al would come by, Al Foster would come by and say, hey, Miles, this guy, this, you know. So we had a band in Chicago. And when we would rehearse, Uncle Miles would call my parents' house and ask my mom to let me hear them rehearse, put the phone down. I mean, so we would rehearse for hours, 2 hours. And at the end of the rehearsal, he would critique us, you know, tell us what to play, work on this, work on that, work on this. And then this went on for about a month. And one day he said, ask us if we want to make a record. And he flew us to New York to make Man with the Horn. So we rehearsed at the Brownstone, like Lenny said, and Dave, when they did Bitches Brew. And then we went on to record. We recorded like 30 songs at 30th Street at CBS. And that record was Man with the Horn. And they used two numbers, Shout and the title track, Man with the Horn. And then Marcus and Al and those guys did the second half of the record, the rest of the record. But I want to say this. People say I had, I was the reason he came back out of retirement. No, I'm not the reason. You know, he was ready to work. You know, I didn't have anything to do with it. He would call me from time to time, but only Uncle Miles, when he was ready to work and go out and play again, that's when he decided I'm ready, you know.
Hey, Benson.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
That's it. That's it.
What's FMF?
It's like some sticker, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That's the whole one, huh?
Screenshot.
Wow.
So Uncle Ron,
what
did he play? What did he play? Did he play the next set with that, or what did he do?
He worked it out some kind of way, and then next night they called the place and they flew it out to Chicago.
Wow.
So we know you can do an Oscar Pettiford imitation. You got Miles's horn.
Wait a minute.
Ah, the Harmon mute. Yeah.
Wow.
That's it.
You got a mouthpiece in there too?
Got some lint.
Wow. Yeah, there's a few horns out.
Hold on.
Oh, okay.
That little small cup.
Yeah.
Look at that.
Wow. So Marcus, Vince was telling us about the history leading into A Man with a Horn. Can you pick it up from there, from Miles's interlude between playing, and how did you end up in that scene?
Well, you know, during the period that Vince was talking about, Dr. George Butler, who was the vice president in charge of jazz at Columbia Records, which was Miles's record company at the time, he was trying his best to get Miles to make a comeback, right? So he'd go visit Miles's house. I think Vince even sent a piano over there.
It'd be a brand new, Yamaha piano.
So he was really trying to encourage Miles to come back. So I remember 1980, I got a call for a Miles Davis session, but it was crazy because, you know, I was doing studio work at the time, and the contractor just called me like it was another date, you know? Okay, you know, you got a Coke commercial from 9 to 10, and then you got a session for Dave Grusin from 12 to 3, and then 6 to 10, Miles Davis. So you good for those? I'm like, wait, hold up. Anyway, I showed up for that session. Buddy Williams, Lou Volpe, guitar player, Paul Buckmaster was the arranger. Mm-hmm. And Paul had written some music. Paul had done some arrangements, some string arrangements, or some kind of arrangements for Miles in the past, in the 70s. And he did a lot of stuff at Elton John, right? Anyway, we recorded. Miles never showed up. So it was like, okay, that was that. A year later, I was on a R&B record date, and then the studio receptionist handed me a note that says, call Miles. You know, so it was either, you know, Lenny White or one of my friends playing a joke on me, or it was really Miles, but I couldn't take the chance that it wasn't Miles, so I called, and it was him. And he said, look, I'm going to studio in an hour and a half. Can you make it? Can you make the session? So I was like, are you going to be there? Referring to the year before. And then, you know, he cursed me out and said, yeah, I'm going to be there. So it turns out that, that Bill Evans, saxophone player Bill Evans, you know, Miles had decided he wanted to put a band together. He called Dave Liebman, who played with the 70s band, and said, can you recommend a young saxophonist? Because I want to put together a young band. And Dave Liebman recommended Bill Evans. And so Bill was hanging out with Miles during that time. You know, he was going to like the boxing gym with Miles, you know, really forming a relationship. So Bill began to make recommendations, you know, and I'm sure like Al Foster was making recommendations too. Miles asked Bill, he needs a funky bass player. Who's a funky young cat in New York? And Bill recommended me. And so I got that call from Miles. And, you know, I showed up at the studio, man, and within, first of all, I was looking up in the sky for him when I got to the studio. You know, I was like, this is Miles Davis. So he was like 5'7", man. So that was like, oh, wait, he's a human being? You know, that was a trip. But we recorded that day, you know, we recorded like he gave me two notes, real cryptic, you know, everybody's experienced that. He gave me two notes. And so I just played those two notes. And he stopped the band and said, oh, you're going to do is play two notes? So I said, oh, okay, my bad. You know, we started again, and I played 135 notes. And he stopped the band and said, what the hell are you doing, man? Just play the F sharp and G and shut up, man. Right? So I was like, okay. But Lenny White knows we grew up with enough imitation Miles Davis's, you know, band leaders who were trying to be like Miles, be cryptic, and be conflicting instructions, you know what I mean? So I said, yeah, no, I know this story. This is the real cat, but it's the same thing. So I just ignored him, played what I thought was appropriate. And we finally got through the whole take. And he said, man, y'all play like a bunch of sissies. But he didn't use the word sissies. You know, it was Al Foster on drums, Barry Finity on guitar, Sammy Figueroa was playing percussion. Bill Evans was on the saxophone.
Was Tio there, Marcus? Tio was
in the control room, absolutely. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, you know, at Columbia Studio. So man, he said, man, y'all play like a bunch of things, and just walk out the studio, you know. But I was closest to the exit door. And as he passed by me, he gave me a wink, you know, and that made me a little bit more comfortable, you know. I told him I was Wynton Kelly's cousin, thinking that might like break the ice a little bit. He was like, so? But he could let it sit there because it was Wynton Kelly. He said, nah, man, that dude had a bad touch. The boy swung his ass off, you know. So I said, okay. The session didn't last that long. He invited me to his house. He said, come by my house tomorrow. Right? So I said, okay. So I, the next day I go to the Brownstone on the Upper West Side of New York, not far from where Mr. Carter lives. And I knocked on the door, and this European lady, maybe she was German, right? She answered the door, can I help you? I said, yeah, I'm Marcus. Miles told me to come. Oh yeah, you're the bass player, come on. So she brings me into the Brownstone and she says, he's upstairs. So I go upstairs and he's sitting with this other lady listening to what we had recorded the day before. And he goes, oh man, come in here, come in here. So I say, okay. So I come in and I sit next to him, man. He's, man, you played your ass off, man. And he's listening to the music and we're listening to for about 45 minutes. And then he goes, how'd you get in here? And I said, you know, the lady, the German lady, let me in. He goes, oh, how'd you know she was German? I said, well, she has an accent. He said, did you make out with her in the hallway?
Now, Marcus, he didn't say make out. Come on now.
Say make out.
Her name was Ursula, Marcus. I think her name was Ursula.
Okay. So Ursula, did you make out with Ursula in the hallway? So I laughed, you know, I'm laughing, you know, no, man. And he goes, did you? And I said, no. Ursula, get your ass up here. So Ursula comes up and he says, what did I tell you about making out with my band members in the hallway? And I'm like, Miles, this didn't happen. What are you doing, man? And she goes, Miles, look, you've been on my case all day. I'm really tired. He says, get out. Get out. So she gets out. And I'm like, whoa, this is all the stories I've heard are true, right? This dude's out there. So we sit there for about another half hour listening to music. Then he goes, call Ursula. I said, she's gone. Oh, she's here. I said, you told her to leave. He said, no, she's downstairs, girl. So I go downstairs. I'm looking for the lady who I know is left. And I'm walking around checking out the Brownstone at the same time. You know what I mean? Like, anyway, I come back up and say, hey, man, she's gone. He calls her, curses her out on the phone. Now he's in a really bad mood. I don't know how this thing, like, took such a bad turn, you know? We go to the studio because he's going to do another session. We take a cab to the studio. He gets to the studio. He just lays into Tio Macero. Just lays into him. Man, where's my money, Tio? Okay, he just goes off on Tio. Leaves the studio. We don't play one note, okay? And so this is my first introduction to this cat, you know what I mean? And the next day I get a call from his manager saying, you know, Miles is gonna, you know, asked you to come back to the session. I said, is he going to be there? Is he okay? Don't worry, it's just Miles. Anyway, we recorded maybe four songs for Man with the Horn. The rest of the album was recorded by Vince and his crew. And the album came out. And Miles called me in June and said, hey, man, I need you. We're going on tour. I said, okay. When's the tour start? He says it starts on whatever day. I said, hey, man, I can make all the gigs. I just can't make the first one because I'm committed to going to Japan with a saxophone player named Sadao Watanabe. And, you know, when you're a young musician, you don't realize how you can mess a band leader up trying to tell them that you can make all the gigs except the first one. You know, I was, you know, 20, 21 years old. I didn't realize. So anyway, he keeps calling me back. I said, man, I can't. I gave my word, you know, like Mr. Carter. I gave my word to the Japanese cats. It's a month-long tour. I can't make, you know. And he goes, man, if you don't do this gig, I'm going to call Japan and tell them I ain't never coming there no more, right? And he said, ain't nobody bigger than me in Japan except maybe the king. I said, Miles, Japan ain't got no king. So he kept calling me. He kept calling me. And although I wasn't as resolute and I didn't assess the situation as quickly as it seems like Mr. Carter did, I eventually said, listen, I got to call the Japanese people and see if they'll let me out of this gig. Okay. So I did. And the Japanese Sadao Watanabe's people, they flew to New York, met me in a hotel in a restaurant on Central Park South to tell me that it was okay. I said, you guys could have just called me. But they were so honored to be part of that situation, to be part of the Miles Davis, because he's making a big comeback. They were so honored. They wanted to officially fly to New York to tell me that it was cool. So anyway, exactly.
Hey, Steve, you know, I played with Ron Carter, I said, from 1969. And I played a gig with him at the Blue Note. And it was with the great Cuban piano player.
Gonzalo?
No, not Gonzalo.
Oh, you talk about from Irakiri?
Yes. Who was the guy that was in Irakiri? Chucho Valdez. Chucho Valdez. And I played with Ron really for 50 years. And at that gig, during the break, I said, can I ask you a question? He said, yeah, sure. I said, you trust me now, don't you? And he said, yes. For me, that was a high honor because I played with all of you guys. And the bass drum situation is premium. And trust is the main thing. You know, Marcus, we played together a lot. Mm-hmm. I trust you. You trust me. That's why it works. Ron Carter, Dave Holland, Munch. There's trust. That trust factor is what really makes the magic. And that's because we rely on each other. Yeah. Ron Carter can play all of what he wants to play because he trusts me to hold the groove. Right. The same as you guys. That's the answer. Is trust is the highest dynamic.
Hey, Marcus, I remember you sharing a story with me one time about, I guess, early days with you playing with Miles and when he finally gave you a bass solo and you went up high.
Yeah.
What was that story?
You know, I didn't take many solos with Miles. You know, I was just like happy just to be there. But towards the end of my run, he started to me a solo. He started, pointing at me. So I would solo, you know, and I'd go up high and play my stuff. And, you know, he's like, man, you've been practicing. I said, well, not just the first time you asked me to solo. He said, you think you could solo and play the bass at the same time? Right? So I'm like, okay, man, he's just asking some more crazy stuff, you know? And then as I thought about it, I said, what's the thing that makes bass solos suck the most? The fact that when the bass player is soloing, nobody's playing the bass, right? It's all the stuff, you know,
people
it's like,
stop dancing.
Yeah, people go order a drink, you know? And I'm going, the groove stops because it's just a drummer, you know, especially with acoustic bass, the drummer's just, you know, he starts just playing with the hi-hat and he lights his cigarette up, you know what I mean? So it's like, I'll start to go to myself, could I keep the bass line going and solo at the same time, you know? And, you know, maybe with straight ahead it's more difficult, but with funk, I was just like, I was always hitting those checkpoints, you know what I mean? So that, like, I had my own bass player, you know what I mean? Almost like a piano player with his left hand, yeah. You know what I mean? So Miles' suggestion originally sounded crazy to me, but I realized that, you know, he had a way of making complicated things real simple, you know what I mean? He could see right through the complications to the root of an issue, and it really helped me.
That to me has really become a staple signature of the Marcus Miller sound to me.
And Dick, it's also a staple of your teaching now. I've heard you explain that using Marcus as the example to so many students over
all the time.
Yeah.
All the time. I use Marcus as an example, you know, and as the example, as a lot of us electric bass players, myself included, and Stanley a lot too, you know, we go on tour and we bring another bass player with us, mm-hmm. you know, and I see Marcus out there by himself. And then I finally got smart and said, oh, that's why he can do it by himself. You know, and when you shared that story during, I think it was during the SMV tour, you shared that story with me. It was when I finally got it. I was like, that makes complete sense.
Hey, Mr. Carter, can I ask you a question, man? I've asked you this before. You were the only one in the 70s who figured out how to get a great sound out of that Marcus Berry. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like the bass, the acoustic bass sound changed. Like if you listen to you in the 60s, it's, you know, the sound that we're used to hearing on all those classic Miles records. But then you went and had a really different sound, but equally incredible in the 70s, like on
the CTI records.
CTI records and stuff, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Stanley Turrentine.
Mm-hmm.
Sugar, sure.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Jim Hall Concerto.
Yeah. How much work did you do to figure out how to get a sound? Because a lot of the acoustic bass sounds in the 70s, they were still working out that technology. You could tell that the bass sounded kind of thin and it wasn't driving the band like it used to. So how much work did you put into that?
Those guys didn't understand that you don't plug in and turn on. You have to understand, one, how the amp works. You have to be willing to invest some hours. For almost 6 months, Marcus, I would go out to Rudy's Van Gelder's on Saturday. My sons would get in the corner and read some books, and we would spend 4 to 6 hours trying various microphones.
Oh, wow.
Various places in Rudy's room to record.
Wow.
You know, at the time, pickups were just now really being developed. They were evolving. And certain guys who were trying to amplify their bass, they just grabbed any one of them and thought it was going to work. Well, right. It worked for bass A, but it won't work so good on bass B and C for some real reasons, you know? And I think one of the things Rudy and I, this two things we decided. One, you have to, if you're using the air mic, you have to know how far away from the bass to put the microphone.
Yes.
Because bass players, as a rule, and when I have a student, we go to bass 101, how the bass functions.
Mm-hmm.
And I explained to them that the bass sound is like a cone. It starts at the bass and it spreads out like a V.
Mm-hmm.
Somewhere in this V is the optimum sound for the bass.
Yes.
And the bass will keep trying to sound, we'll keep trying to fill that room as it is until when it gets back to you, there's nothing left.
Mm.
Not much to record. So Rudy and I were fooling around with what kind of a barrier, what kind of gobo could we put in front of the bass, and how far would it be from the bass so the bass sound evolves far enough away from the bass so you hear the real sound of the bass, and where should the mark on be put in lieu of that kind of scientific measurement? And we would do that, man, for 3 or 4 hours every Saturday for almost 6 months, man.
Wow. See,
and he decided,
I knew something, I knew it wasn't an accident.
No, we put the time in. He decided he liked this microphone. And the other thing Rudy would say would guys would come in and ask him, how did he get that Ron Carter sound? He said, well, first thing, Ron's bringing the sound to the studio.
Yeah, if you want the Ron Carter sound, just call Ron Carter.
Yeah. Yeah. See, he's bringing a sound to the studio. Mm-hmm. Not just plugging in the plant, he's putting a sound into the amplifier.
You know, a lot of particularly
jazz festivals, you know, bigger venues.
Yeah.
You go in here, you know, your jazz set, and the drummers, you can hear everything. He's playing piano players, mic'd up beautifully, you know, everybody you can hear. But for me, I'm thinking to myself, and particularly the more advanced the harmony gets, the less I can hear the bass player, the less I understand the music.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I'm just like listening, going, I thought I knew this song when they started it, but I don't know where I'm at in the song because I can't hear the fundament, you know, hear the fundamental, you know. And so, but that is one thing that whenever I've heard you play, I have always been able to hear what is going on. I've always been able to really discern what's going on up to my harmonic ability.
Ouch.
You're playing B's in a G minor. That's a little over my head.
Hey, Daryl, not so, man. I've heard you do that with the Rolling Stones. You can pull that off with Keith.
Well, you know, the rock and roll is one of the main ingredients of rock and roll. I always tell people is irreverence. I don't care.
Hey, Dave Holland.
Go ahead, Marcus.
Dave, guys were starting to play with really low action right around that time that you were talking about. Did you ever get tempted to lower your strings?
No, I didn't. You know, I started playing at a time when there was no amplification, right? So
right.
Sometimes there was nothing. Sometimes you'd put a microphone in the bridge or something, or on a stand in front of you. So my action was quite high when I was first coming up in my late teens. And mm-hmm. I think even when I joined Miles, I wasn't using an amp at all. The thing is, you know, if you have a low action, it limits how much tone you can get out of the instrument. So, you know, you need to find a place where you can have the strings high enough so that you can get a good tone and also variety of tone. You know, if they're real low, you can only get one sound out of the string.
Right, right.
And if they're high enough, you can touch the string in different ways, produce different characteristics in the sound, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I did bring my action down a little bit over the years, especially, you know, like when you're working in the higher positions of the instrument.
Yeah.
I think if you've got a really high action, it limits your ability to move on the strings up there. But I don't do a lot of playing in the high register. I love the sound of the low part of the instrument. I love the characteristics of the bass, you know.
Yes.
Really bringing out that quality of the instrument. And, you know, sometimes you have to do a lot more work moving your hand up and down, you know, moving more territory on the instrument. But to me, that's the sound that I fell in love with when I was listening to Ray Brown and Leroy Vinegar, you know. And that's kind of what I've always wanted to produce myself. I gave up on trying to sound like them, you know. That was a futile attempt, but it was a good good role model to kind of start with, and then after that you find your own sound.
John Patitucci is, and I got to call him out on this because I've seen it happen so many times. We have so many bass students, and it that show up at Berkeley, double bass players with ultra low action. And every semester they spend with John Patitucci, who's there on the faculty as a visiting artist, as well as Victor. But John in particular, I notice every time they come back in my office for something to deal with the chair, their action's just a smidge higher. And by the fourth semester, fifth semester, John, you got them in the sweet spot. And I'll say this, there's some well-known electric bass players out there who used to swear by the low action and turn the amp up and all of that until John Patitucci got on them. And one visited John Patitucci's house. And the next thing I see him, his Willis ramp is gone. And I played his bass and it felt like a bass again. Thank you, John.
Yeah. Well, thank the two men in this window right here, Mr. Carter and Mr. Holland, because they informed my sound concept, as did Ray Brown and people like George DeVivier and Sam Jones and Percy Heath. And, you know, the physics that they were just talking about, too, is just unavoidable.
Yeah.
The bridge is connected to the strings. The bridge drives the sound post, which drives the top of the instrument. If there's not enough sound happening to make that thing vibrate, you got nothing. Yeah. My journey in all this was, I was very frustrated coming up, as Marcus said, in the 70s too. I'm 61 years old, so I came up with no amp at first with this, but I was playing electric first. So when I finally got into the studios and everything, the engineers were trying to get us all to use the pickup all the time in the 70s, and a lot of times live gigs, you had to fight to try to have a sound. And for a while I had my action a little lower out there, and I just got frustrated. I wasn't getting enough sound, and listening to these guys on these records and all these men that I'm just talking about, I just said, okay, I'm going to have to pull a sound. That's it. I don't care about the high register, the low register. If I have to work harder in any register, I'm just going to do it because I want to make sure that thing is vibrating.
Getting close to the end of the reel, but we still got some tape. And we haven't gotten to Daryl. And Daryl, I would love to hear your perspective. Marcus has left the band, and how did it all come about? I know Vince plays into your Miles Davis history as well.
Yeah. Well, to follow what Mr. Carter and Mr. Holland say, I'm not sure what it was about my playing, but I do know that I was paying attention in a way that, and in a way, my, you know, the people that I was playing with in Chicago before I left Chicago and started playing with Miles, played with a guy named Otis Clay. And he's a soul singer in the same, strain as Otis Redding, you know, Southern guy, you know, big voice, big guy, huge voice. I did some gigs with him. I had him come on a gig that I played in Chicago a few years ago. And when we rehearsed in my parents' living room, and we had our amps and stuff. And he came in to sing his couple of songs, no microphone. And he buried us because his voice was so big, you know. He was just incredibly powerful. But one of the things that I learned playing with him, he would be into the song, he would start dancing around a little bit and he would bend over to take a bow, and that meant the song was supposed to be over. So it meant that you really had to pay attention to what he was doing. And when I played with his band, I guess I must have been about 19, so it's a couple of years before I started playing with Miles, I started really taking that in and saying to myself, I want to watch what the musician who's leading the band is doing. And I want to watch it in a way past listening to it and past, I want to just kind of have put my antennas out and really try to understand his intention, you know? And so I started that with Otis Clay, and then the guys who were the horn players in the band when they would take a solo. And so it's something that I really started developing before I started playing with Miles. And then I get to New York and I'm on stage with Miles, And I was just laser focused. I was listening with everything that I had. I was playing with everything that I had. I asked Miles once, I got one of those Pro Walkmans from Japan before they even came to the States. And I asked Miles, my mother said, Terrell, you should ask Miles if you can record on stage. I would record the gigs and just, you know, have something to listen back to and learn from. And at one point I listened back and there was some noise on the tape and I realized it was me. I was humping so hard that I was like, you know, so I was giving everything that I could in terms of playing, but I was also listening and trying to take in everything that everybody was playing to such a, and if you look at tape of me playing with Miles, wherever he goes on stage, I'm following him. And there's two or three things that happen where I was like, he's about to do something. And I would just trust myself and say, and go. And then he would go and then he would look up at me like, how did you know I was going to be there? But it was because I practiced that. I really tried to tune into that. So if there's anything that he saw in me, it was that I was giving it everything I had. I was listening the best that I could listen. I was playing the best that I could, you know, that I could play with the most passion, with the most sensitivity at the moments where that, you know, where that came. So I guess if there is anything that maybe he was witnessing or that he was, you know, seeing in my playing, it would have had been something like that.
Oh, that's amazing. And what's even more amazing is Vince earlier was talking about that transition period and brought up the name Bill Evans as being one of those catalysts in that period where Miles came back, which led to Marcus and all of that. And lo and behold, the beautiful thing of Zoom and this pandemic, number one, nobody has a gig, so we're all at home. And number two is we've learned how to connect and we can make things happen that kind of blow my mind from a year ago. And I look at my screen, I hear a ding, somebody's entered the room and I look down and I see Bill. So thank you, Victor, or whoever reached out, and however it happened, it's just a beautiful thing. But Bill, welcome. And I'd love to get some input from you on your relationship early, the beginning of your relationship with Miles and any observations you want to make.
Wow. Well, you know, it was an interesting time because I was so young and he was coming out of his retirement thing, which meant he was a little out of control a little bit as far as, you know, that's the best way to put this. You know, I didn't do drugs, never did drugs. I was never into that kind of thing. And at the time, he was doing a few things and he was drinking a lot of beer. And so I was more or less, it's like my new best friend was Miles, you know, and I'd go up and see him every day. We'd talk music and whatever, but I'd also try to keep him out of trouble. You know, I'd take him out after hours places. I'd make sure that he was, you know, just a short version of this, that he wasn't going to get in any trouble with anybody. And there was situations where I sort of had to get in between and say, hey, listen, I've got this. It's under control. Come on, Miles, we're leaving. And a couple of times I picked him up and carried him up the stairs from a few places and said, we're going home now, you know, and he'd get there and he'd go, and then we'd start laughing and then we'd leave, you know, but it was, that's how that early beginning part for me was. So that I'm going from college to that. And so it was sort of like a growing up really fast in New York and everything else, you know, that's how that kind of was. And then slowly, and Vince, that's where I met you, that first few months, because Miles was going in the studio. I'll give you the real short version. It's an honor to see everybody up on this screen. It's pretty amazing. You know, he was getting back into music and stuff like that. And that was sort of what it was, you know, just sort of like being around every day and just waiting to see what he wanted to do and making sure he wasn't going to get any trouble. That's kind of what I was thinking in the back of my mind. I don't know if he was thinking that, but that's what I was thinking.
I hate that we are running out of tape, but I love to go around the room at the end and let everybody give us one last blast. But in this case, and I'm bringing this up because I've heard a couple of you, Daryl, in particular, talk about one thing that Miles told him, or one thing, one little life lesson, or one tidbit. I think Mr. Carter already mentioned it, but feel free to share one of those with us. And since we do have so many students watching, I'd love for you to just share something educational for them to help them get through this pandemic with us. And so I'll just go around the room in the order that it's on here, so people don't step on each other. But I'm going to do something I rarely do. I'm going to start with the drummer.
Oh,
Vinny White.
For one particular thing, I don't think it is. I don't think it's like that. I don't think it is one particular thing. I mean, you know, when you're around someone like Miles who has a vision, and I think one of the things that Miles was able to do is to pick people to come within his sphere that he thought could at least attempt to hear the things that he heard in his head, or give him some impetus to hear something different than what he's heard before. And the thing is, Miles has listened to all different kinds of musics and is a way, I mean, he has a way of doing that, capturing that and putting his stamp on it. And everybody that he chooses, knowing that he has a perspective, or he's able to at least talk with them to get them to open up. So, you know, I don't think it's one thing. I think, you know, you have to be totally open and to be able to think. That's what all students should be able to do.
Great. Daryl.
Kind of in line with what Lenny just said, you know, music is to be played. It is not to be held as some kind of crystal or. But at the same time, there is a certain amount of reverence when musicians find a way to bring some reverence to the music, that I think it helps everything. It's kind of what I was saying about listening, you know, that's where the magic is. Just having reverence for the music. It goes to what Lenny said, you know, Miles having this kind of, creating this kind of atmosphere where, you know, you're giving of yourself to it, and you're open to give yourself to it, and you're open to listening and it's past listening. It's past that. I don't even know the word for it exactly, but, you know, I think, treating the music with a certain kind of reverence.
Yep. That's beautiful. Hey, Bob Hurst, you snuck in here, and I'd love to hear your reflection on Miles, or anybody in this room, their relationship with Miles or yours. Anything you want to share?
Not too much, because I kind of feel out of place being here, but I do want to show appreciation for each and every one of these bass players that created a palette for great music, and then and just for great musicianship to exist. That's why we're here as bass players. And I think you guys did it as, you know, for Miles Davis, which I'm just in complete awe of, you know, seeing each one of you have that connection with him. And I think each and every one of you, you know, and I've studied you profusely, you know, yeah, that's really all I have to say, man. You know, y'all keep doing your thing, man, because I'm just a bystander.
Yeah, and you move the ball forward. Also move the ball forward, Bob. Let's not.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, just as far as the subject you were kind of covering, you know, I think something that was being spoke about earlier about trust, I think Lenny was talking about that. And the thing that, you know, right away you felt playing with Miles was how much he trusted the musicians that he asked to play with him. There was there wasn't a lot of instruction giving, if any. You know, I mean, I had so few things said to me during the 2 years I played with him. It reminded me of a story that I heard about John Coltrane when he first joined the band. He kept asking Miles, you know, Miles was kind of being a little kind of distant from him, you know, personally. And so Train was thinking that he was doing something wrong, you know. So he kept going to Miles and saying, Miles, how do you want me to play? What do you want me to do? This is the story I heard anyway. And it illustrates the point. And Miles just kept kind of turning his back on him when he would ask him. And so finally he said, you know, look, please, you know, just tell me what direction I should. He said, that's for you to find out. You know, it's up to you to find out what needs to be played, you know. And I think that was a big part of what I felt and how he dealt with the musicians in the band. So it kind of gives you a chance to sort of feel confident to try things and to, you know, to push the envelope of your playing.
Thank you. Thank you, Dave. Marcus, from two notes to 137 notes and then back to the history you made with Miles, both playing and as a producer, I'll say it with many other artists, and like everybody else in this room has influenced generations of bass players. Is there a takeaway from your time in his band that you can kind of distill down to a something something?
Well, yeah, there's a million of them, but there's two things.
We'll just take 137.
Exactly. One thing is that I really wanted, because I grew up in a neighborhood of musicians, and everybody had such a distinct sound, even at a young age. I'm talking about trumpeter player named Tom Brown, keyboardist Donald Blackman, Bernard Wright, Lenny White was there, Billy Cobham is from the same neighborhood. So it was like, playing with technique and all that was cool, but when we had a jam session, you know, I parked my little 73 Monte Carlo two blocks from the jam session, and you can hear the music and you could tell who was in the club just from hearing that. And so that was really what we valued in that thing. So I remember Lenny took me to see Star Wars where it first came out, like 1976-77. And after the movie, we talked about how great the movie was, but I said, man, I'm really trying to find my own sound. And how do you go about doing it? You know? And Lenny said, hey man, you just keep playing, be true to the music. And one day you're going to hear a recording and you're going to go, whoa, that's me. So that sounded kind of like he didn't really have a real answer at the time, you know, sounded like a paint on, paint off from Karate Kid. Right. But I'm playing, and then I got the call from Miles Davis, and kind of up to that time, you could hear my influences very clearly. You could hear Larry Graham, Stanley Clarke, you know, you could hear Jaco Pastorius. But now I'm sitting there with Miles Davis, and I didn't want to waste the opportunity. Playing with Miles Davis sounded like somebody else, mm-hmm. right? And so I think he did this with a lot of musicians. Just who he was, particularly later on in his life with all that history behind him. You didn't want to waste the opportunity. You know what I mean? So you really dug down and tried to find something to add to his story because his story was so profound and so immense. You know, so I remember that first day playing with Miles and recording. And after we recorded, we went into the control room to listen. And I go, well, I don't know if it's good, but it definitely is me. You know what I mean? And I said,
Vince, I'm curious to hear your perspective, both as a family member and as a musician.
Well, Steve, we're talking about somebody who was, he always told me to be true to the music, you know, be fearless. I call this Miles Davis University because each of one of us, we carry a little bit of Miles in us. You know, I have dreams about him to this day. He's been gone, it'll be 30 years this year. You know, and I, Marcus, I mean, all of us, we talk, Lenny, we talk about certain things that Miles said, that he shared with us. And when I go on, when I play with any of these guys, Uncle Ron, Daryl, I haven't played with Mr. Holland, Marcus, it's a comforting, you know, a drum bass thing that it's going to be, you know, I know I don't have to worry. You know what I mean? It's like, I got my point guard. I got the right guy.
It gets back to that trust.
It's got to be trust, Steve. If you don't have any trust, then what do you have? You know?
So yeah, Bill, please share something that we can take put on our bumpers.
Trying to make something quick. You know what I always found really interesting is he found his way to have a personal relationship with each person, a separate relationship with each person. So you get to know him really well in your way. You know, he knew how to relate to you. You know, and he, you know, like he loved Daryl, he loved Marcus and all the guys, you know, and he just had a way of centering in. So at that time when you're with him, he gave you the feeling he's your best friend. And he felt like just, and you have to sometimes think to yourself, whoa, you know, like if I'm walking down the street with him in Columbus Avenue and thinking, geez, I'm walking with Miles Davis. You know, I forget that not Miles, my friend, my buddy, my whatever. No, this is Miles Davis. You know, and Daryl would talk about that on the road and stuff. And it's a kind of a trip. And I, sometimes late at night, he didn't like to be on his own late at night at that time. So we'd sit and have a glass of wine and tell stories. And he'd tell all these stories. I wish I remembered half of them, but. And I said, well, what made you?
It's amazing. Sensei Carter, I saved the deepest for last.
Well, you know, of the 5 years I was with Miles, we were all in the band, George, Wayne, Herbie, and me. We were really aware of Miles' physical difficulties, not just the drug abuse or drug use, but his bad hips, stuff, arthritis. We all would see him walk and what a hard time he had walking up on steps, for example. Or we'd see how hard it is. It was difficult for him to, when he would be off between tunes or between solos, how hard he would have to walk to the stage because his diaphragm was shot. You know. But he came to play as best he could. He saw every night playing with us. It's a chance to make some great music. So from one of the things I take from our relationship is the understanding that for as much stuff that's going on around us that's awful, that's terrible, and we can think of the events that were happening while we were going to work, or, you know, playing with him during those difficult times let me know that you have to look at going to work every night as a chance to play some wonderful music. That's why I'm so intolerable to guys who go to work and fuck around. I just can't stand that. This is a chance to play some good music. If you don't like the guys in the band, don't go to work. Stay home. But here's a chance for you, man, not just to make some new friends, but to play some wonderful music. And I'm at the beginning of my career right now, and I've had some wonderful chances to play some great music, and I don't regret one minute of it. No, I love all those guys. I love all the chances I had. I love that I didn't make the changes right. I love that I missed some notes. I love that these guys will expect me to do the same thing tomorrow night. And that's what I'm counting on. And that's one of the things he brought to the gig every night.
Victor Wooten, you have been conspicuously quiet because I've been conspicuously loud.
I mean, for me, you know, I'm in a room full of royalty. I want to take it in, not put it out, you know. I mean, there's not a whole lot for me to say in this crowd, but a whole lot for me to take in. And I hope, the rest of the people out there can learn from that. Because we so quickly want to put our opinion in as if we know what's really going on. And for me, you know, I never met Miles. I never played with Miles. Of course, we all know his music. So there's not a whole lot for me to chime in unless it's a question. But, you know, when I look at places like Facebook and social media, everybody wants to act like they know what's going on rather than ask a question and really listen for the answer. And we get a lot of problems because everybody's the best quarterback from their couch, right? And never been in the game. So, you know, I'm 56 years old and I'm a youngster. So there's no way I'm going to get out there and try to tell people what to do. And it seems like that's what Miles was doing. And I wish we could all in life take the musical approach to life. Because in music, we listen to each other first, right? It doesn't matter what you play on stage. I'm not going to judge it. I'm going to do my best to make whatever you said, whatever you played, better. Where in life, we just want to prove how wrong you are and how right I am. That's not the musical approach. And from all these beautiful things I'm hearing people saying about Miles, Miles was that way. He was about making you think, give you something to think about that brought you out. And I don't hear anybody saying that Miles made you think like him. I haven't heard that once in this whole, you know, 3+ hour webinar. No one said, well, Miles just wanted you to think like him. He was doing things that would bring the best out in you. You know, and to me, that's the way life should be. But in too much, we want to tell you how wrong you are, how bad you are, and how right I am, when none of us know nothing. Right? So the musical approach is we recognize our differences. Right? A bass player is not trying to be a flute player. And we don't force the bass player to be a flute. We want the bass to be the bass. We recognize what the bass is and we make the most of it. Right? Not only do we recognize our differences in music, we celebrate them. And the band is better because all the instruments are different. Life is the same way. So the Miles Davis approach to me, from what I'm hearing, is we should live our lives in helping us become better versions of ourselves. And I don't do it just by criticizing you over and over. I need to do it by recognizing your gifts and help you bring them out. And that's what seems to me what Miles was about. Well, how should I play? You figure it out, right? Instead of just telling you, to me, that's very, very powerful.
So usually I'll count backwards and we'll just blast out of here, but this is too cool. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to play something. And this song has been, since the pandemic, and some of you have heard me say it, it is playing right now over at my house in the kitchen, or this album, I should say. And it's been on constant rotation for literally months. And I know Marcus was talking about getting back and listening to records. I've been stuck in this record for a month. I mean, since the pandemic started, month by month, every month that I'm down here in South Carolina and I'm by myself at the studio, I can play whatever music I want any time of day. And this is going in the kitchen the whole time. So I'm going to play it. And if y'all got to check out, but this is one song I can never hear enough of. Thank you all.